pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He sent two of his disciples and said to them,
"Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there."
The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him one by one,
"Surely it is not I."
He said to them,
"One of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish. For the Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, and said,
"Take it. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
"This is the blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will have your faith shaken. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be."
Then Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he vehemently replied,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch."
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass him by. He said,
"Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will."
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test, for the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go see. My betrayer is at hand.
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely."
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. At this, they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I was with you teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, but that the scriptures may be fulfilled."
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed at a distance into the high priest's courtyard and was seated with the guards, warming himself at a fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple and make it famous, and within 3 days I will build another, not even famous.'"
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said to him,
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
At that, the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
"Prophesy."
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's maid came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
"You too were with the Nazarene Jesus."
But he denied it, saying,
"I neither know nor understand what you are talking about."
So he went out into the outer court. Then the cock crowed. The maid saw him and began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
Once again, he denied it. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more,
"Surely you are one of them, for you too are a Galilean."
He began to curse and swear,
"I do not know this man about whom you are talking."
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. He broke down and wept. As soon as morning came, the chief priests, with the elders and the scribes, that is, the whole Sanhedrin held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
The chief priest accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him.
Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of.
Jesus gave him no further answer, so Pilate was amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, he used to release to them one prisoner whom they requested, a man called Barabbas, who was then in prison along with the rebels who had committed murder in a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted again,
"Crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They shouted only the louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them and, after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple and, weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with,
"Hail, King of the Jews,"
and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage, and when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon the Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him, they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha!
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down from the cross, that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,"
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"Look, it is calling Elijah."
One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take him down."
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last.
I invite you to kneel briefly. I invite you to please stand.
the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of the younger James and of Joseph, and Salome. These women had followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who came up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came courageously, went to Pilate, and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having bought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, watched where he was laying.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
First of all, it's great to see everyone. You don't realize how many people are here until you get outside. And I was like, oh my goodness. And so it's just wonderful to see everyone here, all of our visitors. It's an honor and privilege to have you also with us today. And we're very honored to have Father Paul Stewart with us. Father Paul was at the Air Force Base here for how many years?
6 or 7 years.
And he just celebrated, he's in his 50th year as a priest this year. So. So if this is your 50th anniversary, how old does that make you? No, just kidding. No. But it's great to have Father Paul with us. You know, as we begin this most holy of weeks, I think that we're about walking with Jesus. And walking with Jesus through his sorrows. This week we'll be walking with him through his fears, through his sufferings. And I believe this week as we walk with and we identify with Jesus, that as we look at how Jesus handled his fears and sorrows and sufferings, that it helps us to know how to handle it within ourselves, those things that bring us sorrow. Are those things we fear? Are those things or sufferings that may happen in our life or maybe in somebody's life around us? We started Ash Wednesday, where we were marked with that sign of the cross on our forehead. And we promised to turn from sin and be ever more faithful to the gospel. And then for these 40 weeks, 40 days of this Lenten season, through our prayer, our fasting, and our giving alms, I would propose that we've been loosening our hearts, if you want to say. That we've been preparing ourselves to be ever more open to what the Lord has in store for us this week. And helping us to know how to handle sorrows, fears, and suffering. And the first lesson I think we hear today on this Palm Sunday is that no matter what we have to face, we have to start off by having a true trust in the Lord. And I say that because Jesus would have known the first reading today from the prophet Isaiah chapter 50, where the prophet Isaiah says, "Anyone who trusts in the Lord, he will give you a well-trained tongue. For anyone who trusts in the Lord, he will open your ears to be able to hear him. If you trust in the Lord, he will help you turn the other cheek when someone harms you." And then we heard that trust over and over in the Passion reading today. As Jesus trusted in the reality that he was going to have to die. Jesus trusted that he needed to prepare the disciples for some hard times that were about to come. He trusted that even though somebody he cared for was going to betray him, they still had to stay focused on the Father. And Jesus trusted that he had to go to an out-of-the-way place to pray, that not his will would be done, but God's will would be done. And then all that Jesus had to go through is summarized in that second reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians chapter 2, as Jesus is arrested and taunted and betrayed by people. Paul says Jesus emptied himself. He became a slave. He was obedient. He trusted in the Father, even till death, death on the cross. I think our first lesson this most holy of weeks as we begin is how important it is to trust in God. This past week I was talking with a mother. She has 5 children and her youngest is about to go to college in the fall. And she said she's already crying every day. She said, I just can't believe my daughter's going to leave me and she's going to school in Notre Dame, and she was just all upset about it, but she said, I've got it all figured out. I'm going to buy an apartment there, and so we're going to go there so I can be there just in case she needs me, and she had all of this planned out going, and you know, it was all about her and not the daughter. There wasn't a lot of trust in the Lord going on right there, at least, in that conversation. But then I was talking to this other guy, and he was telling me that he was in this toxic relationship with this girl, you know. And she was one of these that would pull you in or give you little crumbles that she cared, but then she would push him away, and she was just real avoidant, and she was always busy with other stuff, and he just felt like she kept pushing him away, but then she'd pull him back in, and he said he was exhausted. And he said that he felt like God told him that he had to break off that relationship, and so he did. He said it was the hardest thing he's ever done in his life. And he said, I think about her every day, but I'm just trusting this is what the Lord wants me to do. I think no matter what we're facing, how big or small, we've got to remember how important it is to trust in the Lord. We've got to keep holding our palms high and praising and giving laud and honor and putting the Lord center in our lives. And this week, as we reflect on Jesus' suffering, his fears, his sorrows, each day this week, we're going to learn a different lesson on how we too can face sorrow or fears or suffering. Our first lesson that we hear today as we hold our palms high is no matter what happens, that we have to always trust in the Lord. Invite you to stand as we profess together. I believe.
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified,
who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
I confess one baptism for
forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Today, Jesus enters Jerusalem as the Messiah. In the suffering and death of Christ, we see God's boundless love for each of us. So with confidence, we pray.
For all who are celebrating the Easter sacraments for the first time, and for the Pope and all the clergy who will lead us through the celebrations of the Lord's Passion, Death, and Resurrection this week, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our Christian brothers and sisters in the Holy Land and throughout the world who are persecuted because of their faith in Jesus Christ, may the Holy Spirit fortify them with courage to remain strong in their faith. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we begin Holy Week, may we be drawn more deeply into the saving mystery of Christ's death and resurrection. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who, like Jesus, carry a heavy cross because of poverty, homelessness, illness, or bereavement, we pray also for those, like Simon of Cyrene, who help them in their moment of need. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Annunciation Catholic School students, faculty, and staff, and all schools here today, that during this Holy Week, those who believe in you, who hope in you, and who love you, will worship you in harmony and with the love which you deserve from them. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, you call us each year to remember your Son's entry into Jerusalem and to celebrate his passion, death, and resurrection. Hear our prayers and give us grace to follow Christ even to his cross. We ask this as we ask all of our prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus. son who did not cling to godliness, but emptied himself, became a slave.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father.
Lord, accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and our Bishop, and all the people of God. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
For through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
And Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And let us offer each other some sign of peace. You know, now they do peace and then some shaking. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be.
Please join us on our communion hymn, number 662, Loving and Forgiving, number 662. Thank you.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you have led us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We invite all of our young boys and girls forward for this time for the children's bulletin. Again, it's great to see everyone this morning, and just want to remind you it's this Holy Week that we'll be having our Holy Thursday service. Will be at 6 p.m. on Thursday. Then we'll have our Good Friday. We will have Stations of the Cross in the chapel at noon, and then we'll have our evening Good Friday service at 6 on Friday. Then we'll begin the Easter Vigil service at 7 on Saturday. We have 18 people coming into the church, and I think at least half of them are here today. And so it's, so we could go ahead and do it now if you want. No, just kidding. So we're really excited about that. So that will start at 7 p.m. on Saturday. Then, of course, on Easter Sunday, we'll have our same 8 and 10:30 services. So hopefully you can come to as many of those services as possible. And also, we have our Easter festival today at the school, so that's from 2 to 4, and so there'll be an Easter egg hunt and all kinds of games and food for the kids, so hopefully we'll see as many of you as can be this afternoon at 2 to 4 at the school. And again, it's great to have Father Paul with us. He was just slipping into town. He didn't warn me. I'd put the guards out. No, just kidding. No, but it is, but we're always happy to have you back here to your little second home away from home, so. And so let us remember as we go into this week, the first lesson that we have is that whatever sorrows we may have, whatever fears we may have to face, no matter what suffering we may have to face, that the first thing we do is we need to always lean on a full trust in the Lord. And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless each of you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
Please join us in our closing hymn, number 713, Take Up Your Cross, number 713.